right. For instance, proposing that you come back on Sunday, but the nightmare of today is that I'm going to speak three times, right? To make sure that I'm going to give you the. We're going to have a quiz this afternoon, so you're going to hear a lot about that. And for that, maybe you can go. That's all for the afternoon. The first problem, which is a very practical one, very hard to solve, is why is my suitcase? I've been waiting for 1 week, nobody cares. So something more practical is that I've been dealing with a lot of biophysics of the receptor-ligand interaction. And in particular, this peptide MHC TCR interaction. And I told you that most of them were measured by SPR. So in a way, by superstatin person. So in a way, you are measuring on-rate and off-rate in 3D in solution. And what I want you guys to think about and maybe try to solve analytically, I don't have many analytical problems that I want you to solve, but once you want to deal with a real model and you want to deal with something happening in the human brain, right? This ligand is embedded inside the dendritic cell, this ligand, this receptor is embedded inside the T cell. So we have to be able to derive these new parameters into the inside the membrane. And it's not rocket science, but it's a nice trick, and I want you guys to be aware of this kind of how you go from one to the other, or how we can use these parameters to be able to derive what we really need. So we might not be able to measure dikes inside the cell.
Does it change you?
Use a little bit that's there. They're much better.
The little one? So, we do it right now. No, that's fine. It's fine, okay. But again, very simple problem. You measure the step in solution. You want to use these parameters to be able to put them in your model and at the right frequency and the right time scale. How do you do these kind of computations? And the second one would be able to keep the noise in the system. So, I didn't go for that too much, but when you look at individual cells, if you look at the dose response of a particular ligand, and you look at the response for aspect rate of the ligand, so this is what I feel on scale, what we observe systematically in these lymphocytes is that you have something which is really digital. The cell is completely off, and then as you sweep with a different amount of ligands, you're going to be able to push the cells above the threshold, and then you're going to get this kind of digital activation. Now, so this is what you measure at the level of a single cell. And I'm going to tell you a lot more about that in the first lecture today, but in terms of a problem to think about for this afternoon, what I want you to, so there is some kind of a threshold that you want to deal with. Now, obviously, this threshold might vary from cell to cells. There might be a distribution for that. And I want you to be able to predict what you're going to measure at the population level. All right, you're going to get the typical dose response that you might be able to fit with a typical heat curve, right? I mean, x to the n to the x0 to the n plus x to the n. So you have kind of a measure of this slope here associated with this heat coefficient. And I want you to be able to derive how you go from individual cells being very digital and very black and white with the activation in something which, when you look at the population, is maybe much shallower. And I want you to think about the way you go from one to the other. So this would be the two simple analytical problems that we can discuss this afternoon. So I don't know if you have time to think about it very much. And the third, I mean, we have just a general discussion. A general Q&A on the immunology and if you're interested what you can do and what can be done in terms of modeling, and maybe I will try to challenge you on a different aspect of immunology to see how you think about it. Okay, so that's me for this afternoon. So for this morning, for the first lecture, I want to mostly discuss issues of phenotypic variability. So in a way, it follows up very nicely with Boris' lecture, right? Instead of dealing with the genetic variability in the accumulation of alleles, here we are dealing with a population of T cells, right? And if you look at the lymph node, inside that you might collect 1 million T cells. Each of them is going to be a node with a different receptors. But even within TCR1, TCR2, and so on and so forth, but even within that population, you might have 10 different cells, 10 different clones of a given T cell. And what I want to discuss about today is that, in fact, I try to present the T cell as something very reliable, the way we distinguish between self and non-self. What I'm going to discuss today is that within this clonal population of cells, they are all identical, they all come from the same mouse, or same human, they all express the same receptors, and yet I'm going to show you that they are extremely noisy in the way they deal with a given self-non-self situation. And this is going to throw a big wrench inside our problem of immunology, because we want to believe that the system is very reliable. We would like to believe that there is some kind of robustness whereby lymphocytes can be very good at discriminating. And I'm going to throw a wrench in that and say that, in fact, they are very noisy, which is something useful, which is also something very important. So that's going to be mostly the topic of today. We're going to look at it in terms of TCR signaling, to follow up on what we were discussing yesterday. And then we look more at cell-cell communication to bridge with the last lecture later in the morning. Okay, so I finished the lecture.
Where's the brush?
I finished the lecture yesterday with this very simple table. I'm just going to recap a little bit what we had. So we have this problem of self-ligands and non-self, derived from a virus or from a pathogen. And again, at the biophysical level, when we look at the typical lifetime of the peptide MHC-TCR interactions, we have something which binds typically less than 1 second, something which binds typically maybe less, more than 10 seconds. And then you look at the threshold of activation, especially in terms of signaling. What I told you is that these are able to respond to a single ligand, particularly. So you give a single peptide to the T cell, it's going to be able to get activity and get going. And this is most likely on the order of 10 to the 5, 10 to the 6. We cannot detect any kind of activation with itself peptide MHC. So again, the challenge is that we start from a small differences at the biophysical level and becomes functionally something which is really huge at the functional level. And again, this is done on a very short time scale, on the order of 1 minute, maybe 1 to 5 minutes. The way we dealt with it, the way we model it, is we start with a typical profiling scheme, right? TCR plus the peptide MHC form a complex which starts the phosphorylation cascade inside the cell. And the idea that I've been harping around over and over again in the last two lectures is that you can measure this off rate as a measure of the quality of a peptide engaging the TCR. But with a kinetic profiling scheme, you can measure it another time here, another time here, and so on and so forth. Right? So by resampling, in a way, the quality of your ligand, you can amplify 10 differences that you have in the off rate into something which might translate to a big difference when you look at the end of the chain. And the idea of the model and what seems to be working very well for us right now is that there is a phosphatase, or something which dephosphorylates this chain, which really acts as negative feedback. Right? So what I finished yesterday is by saying that instead of having a single time scale whereby you're trying to drive this phosphorylation and you try to discriminate between different off rates, now you're going to use a particular phosphatase called SHIP1, which is going to slow down the way you progress from the system. And again, what's very striking with that is that when you look at it at the functional level, when you plot in the model, or when you measure experimentally four different off-rate of peptide MHC-TCR interactions, you look at the number of peptide MHC that you need to activate the cells, and what we get is this very non-linear curve. So this is in log scale, right? Goes from 10 to 5, start at 1, and what you get is this kind of very sharp discrimination. So again, on this, we have the non-self or viruses or bacteria which are able to trigger the T cells. below 1 second, we might have a self. And I discussed this issue of antagonism, all the things in between, which tend to not activate the cells, which can act by activating a lot of cells. So again, well, I left you yesterday with the idea that this discrimination between self and non-self is not something which is set in stone based on the biophysics of these interactions. It's something which is going to be dynamically regulated and completely tunable based on this negative feedback, right? And the idea that there is a set threshold here is kind of dubious. If you take different T cells, they might have different thresholds depending on different level of SHP1. So the more SHP1 you have, the more stringent you are going to be, and you can move left and right this threshold. This is something which can be useful when you are trying to evolve these T cells and make them tune to different self repertoire. But more important and more practical is that when you go back to the lab and you take a particular clone with a given TCR, what you notice is that if you measure, and again that goes back to what I discussed in the first lecture, we can take individual cells from a lymph node, we can pass 100 million cells, we can get at this distribution of expression of a different level of phosphatase or receptors, different things. And what we systematically get, whatever we measure, if we measure the level of TCR, if we measure the level of CD8, measure of SHP1, MAP kinase, anything we want, every time we take a pure population of lymphocytes, they are all identical, they come from the same house, what we always get is this kind of log normal distribution with coefficient of variation on the order of 0.5. Right? Coefficient of variation being sigma divided by the average. So 0.5, I mean, if you are used to this discussion about noise in biology, people have looked at this kind of distribution in the context of bacterial expression and yeast in particular. And in these small organisms, the noise that you get is maybe more on the order of 0.1 or 0.2. So in a way, these are very tight distribution. From one bacteria to its sister, you're not going to get much variation in the level of proteins. When we go back to a higher organism, when we look at mammalian cells, we systematically get this log normal distribution, and the spread is much larger, on the order of 0.5. 0.5 means that if you look within your population of cells, the number of cells which are going to express more than 3x compared to the average level that you have in your system might be on the order of, let's say 3% typically. I don't remember the exact number, but this is something which is readily accessible, right? We're starting with maybe a population of 1 million cells. If you go at that with a log normal distribution, you're going to be able to pick up cells which are non-negligible where you can see these cells. And vice versa, you can find some cells which express maybe 3 times less than the average. So that means that what is the model we are building, which is telling us that there is a very neat, sharp transition which enables lymphocytes to distinguish between self and non-self based on the negative feedback, has to be correct in the context whereby the level of SHP1 is really varying from cell to cell. Right? So if we believe that it's robust, we would say that this has to be set in such a way that the enzymatic activity of this phosphatase is kind of saturated, and despite the fluctuation of the SHP1, we're not going to affect the dynamics of this negative feedback, and we're going to be able to make the same self and non-self discrimination inside the system. So this potentially could be a solution where even though you have a lot of variation from self to self, you are going to pick a network which is going to completely buffer this fluctuation, and it's going to be completely immune to this variation based on the level of SHP1. That could have been a solution.
You mentioned there was a kinase at the end of this pathway.
Yes.
So if you have a cross-correlation between kinase and SHP1,
yes,
presumably you can tolerate that variation.
Right. So in fact, the kinase, which is here, I kind of removed it. It's kind of, again, a negative feedback on the negative feedback. It's not really involved in the way you discriminate. It's not really involved in the way you're going to be able to set the difference between 1 second and 10 seconds. It's more like a fail-proof system which locks the activation of the cells towards activation and then you do something else, or towards non-activation. So in a way, that's why I kind of erase it, because on this short time scale, we don't really care about it. So you can't use, I can show you some, I discussed some experimental data on that, but basically you can modulate this positive feedback and it really doesn't affect the dynamic nature of this network. Okay? Right, so again, what's nice about this system is that we can really go back, harvest some cells from the mice, and we can really make these measurements, right? We have these flow cytometry techniques, which enables us to pass millions of cells at once. We can measure up to 16 parameters on the cells, and in particular, you can start to make a map where you measure the level of chip 1, maybe you measure the level of TCR, maybe you measure the level of different things, or CDH, co-receptor, the level of map kinase, and so on and so forth. And you're going to be able to measure the response of the system in the shape of maybe phosphorylation of map kinase, or some other readout, right? So you're going to be able to make a map of whatever phenotypic variability, phenotypic variability in terms of expression, and then you have the phenotypic variability in terms of the response. And the question, if we have a good model, is that obviously we want to be able to relate one to the other. Given this kind of very simple schematics in the way these T cells are discriminating between self and non-self, if we start to challenge it in a way we are doing a parameter sensitivity inside our model, but instead of doing 30 beam, which we have done, but you can do it experimentally by passing sufficiently large number of cells, staining them for different level of all these components, noticing the variability, and starting to beam for maybe both cells which express a high level of SHIP1, and see if they behave differently inside the system, right? So this is really the way that the model communicates with our data in our case. We can build, originally we had built a very big model, Massimo and Paul and Eric Tiggia have been revisiting it in a more phenomenological and much more understandable manner. Whatever we say has to be robust in terms of predictions. And what we noticed in particular is that when we start to test the threshold of activation inside the system, so for example, we test in the model a different level of shift one are going to influence the threshold of activation inside the system. So this is measured in terms of number of peptide energy that you need to activate the cells. What we have is this kind of curve, which tells us that if the level of shift one remains below a certain level of shift 1-0, which we can describe, all the T cells within that population are going to respond to exactly the same threshold, maybe on the order of 10 ligands. And then, as you push up your model there, and you start to test it for higher level of shift 1, what you get is a sudden divergence, right? This is very nonlinear because it's really getting activated and going back dephosphorylated. So there's a very sharp nonlinearity in the system, which completely explodes the threshold of activation. That means that all the cells here are not going to be able to get activated, but all the cells here are going to be able to be activated. So what we are predicting is that in a way there is a very sharp sensitivity to the exact level of dephosphatase in our model, which means that within the population of cells, if we have too much of this SHIP1 phosphatase, if we have too much negative feedback, we will never get these T cells to get activated. So you notice that I plotted it like that, because practically when we overlay on top of that the distribution of expression of SHIP1, we have again this non-normal distribution, and we should be able to find a subpopulation of T cells which express so much SHIP1 that you don't expect them to be activated at all. No matter what you do, you will never be able to activate them. They are completely loaded with negative feedback components. You are never going to be able to express them. But then everybody behind that is going to be activatable with a kind of very comparable threshold. So we can do this experiment. And what we notice is that when we do the experiment, so we can measure level of SHIP1. We can measure, for example, phosphor. So I can only plot you this thing is to be right now. And indeed, we see something which is like that. So again, this is a single cell measurement. We harvest T cells from a lymph node or a spleen, activate them in vitro. And what we see is that when we co-stain for different level of SHIP1 and the response in these cells, you get this really black and white dichotomy inside the population. Those under T cells which express too much SHIP1 will never get to be activated. And all the cells which are below a certain level, you can activate them. In fact, you can activate them with the same cell. So this So now, this is a bit challenging, you know, and I want to spend this lecture emphasizing that, is that when you go back to the lab and you start to test your models, it should really make very good predictions. In particular, when you wire up some kind of a dynamic model with a given parameters, and if you are a bit serious, you go back and you measure the level of all these different phosphatase, kinase, and receptors. If you are set with a very set, small set of parameters, if you do this kind of sensitivity analysis, you might get some very sharp prediction which tells you that your model is in fact very sensitive to parameters. And this you can go back to the lab and test. And in a way, that's one more validation of the model. We can see that this is very controlling the way the system works. So is it clear or? Right, so again, to go back to my initial problem of being able to set up a system which is very good at discriminating, I might solve this problem by adding a very strong negative feedback component, something which really filters out big quantities of very poor ligands. But then the problem that we have is that we're going to lose some T cells. Some of them are never going to be able to be activated. We cannot assume that all the T cells are going to behave the same. There's going to be some noise in the system. And suddenly, instead of thinking of an immune response as a pure, a very accurate decision that T cells are making, each T cell is going to make a different decision based on the level of its kinase, phosphatase, and so on and so forth. So that's kind of the anti-robustness idea, right? Instead of thinking that the system is going to be wired to be able to do these things in a very absolute manner, instead what we are finding is that in fact the system is wired and kind of sitting on the cusp of a bifurcation in such a way that maybe only 50% of the population of within a clone is able to respond, and 50% are just dull and they don't do anything. Right? So no matter what you do, you're not going to be able to use these cells in your immune response. So that's
So is that an additional pressure to suppress ship one variation?
It could have been a nice solution, right? You could say we squeeze this distribution to make sure that everybody behaves the same. What we're finding practically, I don't know the source of the noise. I'm trying to get a good handle on that, but what I can tell you is that practically every time we measure this distribution inside mammalian cells, we get a log normal with at least a CV of 0.5. So meaning that in a different world, the T cell could have spent a lot of time to try to squeeze this distribution to make sure that everybody's kind of wired the same. It seems to be too hard to handle. Maybe you would spend too much energy, maybe you would lose a lot of clones. It's not the case. So I will flip the problem. Given this distribution, what kind of network do you want to use to be able to solve for it, right? So it's a very practical or experimentalist type of response. I cannot manipulate this particular, right? I have no way to force this cell to squeeze, so that's the way. But there is an evolutionary rationale maybe to have the same distribution. Again, if you look at it, you have different level of ship one, again, very negative feedback component. And you look at the threshold of activation. For non-self ligands, and I get something like that. Right? So given the distribution of ship one, which is like that, let's say maybe I'm missing 3% of the cells. I'm not going to be able to, I lose 3% of the cells, let's say, which are not activatable. Okay? You do the same modeling with the self ligands, and what you get is that because it's a self, the curve is going to look like that. What that means is that if you get activated, instead of the single ligands that we have here, we have the cover threshold that we have for the cells, this might be much larger, maybe on the order of 10 to the 4. But more importantly, you see that the number of cells which are going to be above this threshold is going to be, I'm flipping all these curves, so somebody should think that if that's you, you are flipping. Let me restart. I'm thinking of different molecule and it didn't make sense. Alright, so we take this ship one component, we have a distribution which might be very spread out, and we look at the threshold of activation. What I meant to draw, is that the curve should be like that, right? So the typical threshold for the non-cell ligands is going to be very low, and only the cells which are here are not going to be able to be activated. Are completely down and not activatable. And what we found out is that when we do the same modeling and when we do the experiment with the weak ligands, the cell ligands, the threshold of activation might be on the order of 10 to the 4, but more importantly, this threshold in terms of level of shift 1 is here, meaning that now only maybe less than 1% of the cells can be activated. Right? So if you want some kind of evolutionary argument about the way you use this noise and this variability to do something in terms of more specificity, what you are saying is that if you have non-cell ligands, the threshold in terms of how much shift 1 can allow you to signal is fairly low, so practically every T-cell inside your population can get activated. But when you do the same experiment with a cell ligand, when you have too high level, practically nobody can get activated, and you're going to lose the ability of the cell to get activated. So you're not trying to solve this thing universally for all the T-cells, but given this distribution, what you're going to do is that you're going to essentially lose the probability of the cells to respond to cells. And that's good enough at some level, right? You're going to destroy the probability of a given T lymphocytes to get activated by the cell. The price you pay that you're going to lose some cells which are not going to be able to respond to your bug and to the non-cell ligands, but at least most of the T cells are not going to be able to be activated by cell ligands. So, right, instead of thinking of it as some kind of a robust mechanism to really discriminate between self and non-self, you acknowledge that there is some variability. Again, I don't know the source of this variability, but you acknowledge that whenever you try to make a measurement, there's always going to be some noise in the clonal population of cells, and this is going to influence the way these cells get activated at the population level. So I guess the first hard conclusion for this lecture that we can see a lot of phenotypic variability inside the population of cells. Even if we take a pure population, they are all clonal, they all express the receptors, it's a given that they are going to be very variable in the level of receptors, in the level of kinase, in the level of phosphatase. And if you identify the key component, which seems to be the gatekeeper of all these dynamic pathways, having variability in this gatekeeper can give you a lot of variability in the way the cells respond to ligands. So we have a system which generates, in a way, a lot of noise. That's the way the system is wired, or maybe in a different world we'll have something else, but that's a given. And what I'm going to try to argue in the last 5 minutes is that, in fact, it's something which is very useful for the system. If we had something which were very robust, it would not be very flexible. So in a way, this is kind of the way it has been wired, the way it becomes very tunable. You are paying the price in terms of phenotypic variability, but what you gain is that you are going to be able to be very tunable. So it's kind of a trade-off between the two, and the system seems to have to settle for this kind of solution. Right. So again, at that level, I started by telling you last lecture that T-cells are godly, they do amazing stuff in terms of being able to solve this problem. And I'm rating that idea now by saying that there is so much variability in the components that practically even within the pure population of cells, some cells are going to make a mistake, maybe, and get activated very easily. And some cells, no matter what you do, you will never be able to activate them. So it's kind of a very different idea of a very different view of the way this biological system works. You cannot really assume that all these cells inside the clone are going to behave the same. We have to assume that there is a lot of noise in the system, and most likely it's going to be useful at some level, but most likely it's going to be detrimental at some other level, and that's what we're going to try to address in the remaining time. So practically in this particular case, why could it be useful, right? Why having noise in the system can generate some diversity? Why do you want diversity? So if you remember from the first lecture, I mentioned that the number of these cells which can fight a particular bug, the frequency is very low, maybe it's 10 to 100 cells inside the whole body, right? So at a given time, if you go inside your lungs when you're starting to fight your cold, when you go inside your on your skin when you're starting to fight some infection in your skin, practically a single T cell starts the response, right? So your only defense against the infection is a single cell. And we can do experiments to really prove that a single cell is enough to fight an infection. Now the problem that we have is that this single cell has to do a lot of different things, right? It has to become maybe an effector cell, meaning it has to be able to kill, it has to be able to make cytokines, and then maybe you want to save it for later time, so it has to become a memory cell, meaning that essentially it has to remain very quiescent and not try to fight anything. In particular for effector cells, they're going to proliferate like crazy, right? They multiply by a factor of 10 to the 6. Well, these cells are going to essentially stay quiescent, not multiply at all. Can you read it here? Or?
No.
That's not, yeah, then you can really go back to the center and with that line off a little bit better. Can you read that? But basically, you know, it's mostly text, right? And I'm just pointing out that even though we start with a single clone, we have to be able to do many different things. Sometimes we go to the lung, sometimes we go to the tissue, sometimes we're going to make cytokines, sometimes we just remain a memory cell. That means that as you start to expand this individual T cell, it has to be able to diverge in terms of a tree of differentiation. It has to be able to make a lot of different decisions. And this kind of variability, we see it very early on. There is variability in the fate of these cells, right? And you cannot argue for genotypic variability at this level. I'm really starting with a single T cell. I mean, I can really take a mouse, adoptively transfer a single T cell, infect this mouse with a bug like Leishmania or Listeria, come back 1 week later and see what happens to this individual cell, and I will see that they did all these different things. So as they are expanding by a factor of 10 to the 6, they are really filling up all the possibilities in terms of kind of immune response that you have, and we can measure it, we can go back and measure it experimentally, we see that it's very upstream. So this variability, the fact that you can see it at the TCR level, right, the way these T cells are being activated, is kind of a big source of variability. So we have some noise, you know, these cells that are coming with one level of shift, let's say it starts here, and as they start to proliferate, they're going to start to generate, recapitulate this whole distribution. And what I'm saying, you know, related to the question from Boris at the beginning, is that inside this distribution, we want to be able to make sub-beams of population of cells. So maybe the ones which have a very low level of this SHP1 phosphatase, they're going to be hyperactivated, and maybe they're going to proliferate. Right? They're going to be the cells which proliferate like crazy. And the cells which have a higher level of SHP1, in that regime on a short-term scale, they're going to respond very efficiently, you know, comparatively to these cells. But if you look at them on longer time scale, they're going to remain quiescent, and so on and so forth. What I'm saying is that as we are being able to measure these things at the level of individual cells, as we are able to track the way we're expanding these T cells and the way they start to differentiate along this tree of different phenotypes, we see that we want to start to play this game, which is that inside our population of cells, they're going to be like subcompartments, which based on the validity of given DNA components, they're going to be committed to different phenotypes. Now, so, I mean, in that sense, the validity is going to be very useful. It's really the motor to generate a lot of diversity in the system, and that's the only way you're going to be able to fight an infection. You need some cells to go and kill, you need some cells to become a memory if you want vaccination state, right? And it's really because you have so much variability that you can generate all these phenotypes, even though you started from a single T cell. Okay? Okay. So, I mean, I'm kind of arguing about that because, again, when you go to a lot of systems variability papers, people are trying to find some kind of very nice features of robustness and so on. Unless you go back and recheck it in your system, I would be very careful about that, especially if you work in mammalian cells. In our experience working with lymphocytes, every time we look at it, in fact, we see this kind of huge distribution. And every time we look at it, we see that the system is much more noisier than what we would expect. And you can complain about it because it becomes very difficult to fit the model. You have to be able to fit a lot of different phenotypes based on different level of receptors. But that's really a bonanza, because you can really have different phenotypes. You can really test your model in different settings and, in a sense, do a parameter sensitivity at the experimental level. So this was the plus side of variability. Now, the negative side is kind of obvious, and again, why you don't like variability? Well, that's the issue of noise, right? if I'm telling you that there is so much noise in the level of the particular phosphatase, and this seems to impact dramatically the way you can solve this problem of self-to-self discrimination, if I'm telling you that my system is really non-robust, and one given T-cell, the given TCR, might be in a regime where it completely responds to everything it sees, or basically it's never responding to anything, then again, we're going to have a problem, right? Potentially, if you take a given T-cell, a given TCR, and suddenly the level of this SHIP1 component is fluctuating in and out in the system, at some point it's going to be exposed to self-ligands. And if it's unlucky, these self-ligands may be a little bit better than your average self-ligands. You are picking up at a time when the SHIP1 levels are a little bit lower than usual, and boom, you make a mistake and you get an autoimmune disorder. So what I'm saying in a sense is that rather than trying to find a really genetic source of autoimmune disorders, the way a lot of people think about that, what we are saying is that these are kind of the tail of a distribution. Every time the T-cells make a mistake, every time a T-cell is going to respond to the cell because it fails to have enough regulation at the level of the TCR, you are in for a big problem, right? Potentially, you're going to trigger the T-cells, they're going to start to expand, they're going to recognize the cell as something foreign, right? You don't know what it's cell, right? You just got activated by this stuff. They're going to start this whole program, and then you are in for a big problem. And that's really something that we see experimentally, like especially in the case of diabetes. When you go back at the onset, these are T-cells which are recognizing insulin in the pancreas, and you can really gate, you can sort the cells based on different level of receptors, and see that really the cell which expresses a bit more receptors, they tend to be hyper-responsive. When you put that back inside the mouse, you really push the probability of triggering diabetes in a dramatic manner. So there's nothing different, nothing very fundamentally different about those T-cells which trigger insulin disorders. They are just the unlucky one which tend to be miswired, which are missing a little bit of this negative phosphatase, and ultimately they are the ones which are going to trigger a disorder and wreck havoc in the system. Was there a question? Okay. So this is really what we want to deal with, right? I mean, we would have loved to say that the whole problem of immunology can be solved by looking at some biophysics, by looking at some very short time scale. And at some level, we can learn a lot by looking at signaling on the short time scale. As we go along that, we start to find out that it generates new problems in terms of viability of the system. And in a way, you have to take it as a given. Given this noise in the system, what can we do to make the system still behave? What can we do to avoid this spurious activation of T-cells which leads to autoimmune disorders? What can we do to make sure that we have enough T-cells that can respond in such a way that we can really make an immune response? So there is nothing really black and white in the way these things are being done. They're extremely flexible, extremely malleable, extremely tunable, and that's the beauty of the system. There's a lot of variability, so you can adapt to any kind of infection that you're getting. And vice versa, potentially there's a lot of noise, and you might be in for some mistake or autoimmune problem. So this is really about self, non-self, at the level of individual T-cells, at the level of each cell trying to read the repertoire of self ligands and trying to read the quality of the ligands. Right? Again, there might be some very nice sharp features at the level of the individual cell, but I'm telling you now at this stage that it can be extremely noisy and we have to be able to build something about that. Second part of this lecture and the next lecture, I'm going to try to solve this problem on a bigger scale. Right? I've been trying to focus on the first minute of an immune response. What can we say about signaling inside lymphocytes on a short-term scale? We learned something, and that's a very nifty feature which you could use in many systems. You use the negative feedback very upstream to filter out the noise, and that can yield some very sharp discrimination. The payback of that we get a lot of noise in the system, and we're going to deal with that on the longer time scale. Okay. Any questions? You are pacing yourself because I'm going to speak all so many times today. What? One more lecture and then I do the problems.
Don't look so scared.
So, and the theme of this workshop is really about demanding orders, right? I mean, it's nice to look at the signaling cascade as some kind of self-organized signaling cascade, but I think what I can really contribute in terms of the idea of emergence is that we do something on a very short time scale. The demand response takes place over days and weeks and really set up by involving a lot of T cells. So all the rest of what I'm going to tell you about is about cell-cell communication. How can we use individual T cells making a very local decision, sensing different repertoire of peptide MHC, making a black and white decision between cells and non-cells? How can we make these cells communicate with each other in such a way that they're going to make a better decision? Right? How can we use some kind of emerging order in the activation of a population of lymphocytes to make a better decision in terms of cell to non-cell? So again, what we're going to deal with is that taking these cells, naive, meaning they've never been exposed to any kind of antigen, they come endowed with their own receptors, and let's say they get activated. Right? On a short time scale. Well, what's very striking and in a way, very important way we have been used to being able to identify these lymphocytes and to learn how they behave is that they are going to move to a regime where they are activated. Right? And what's very striking is that when they are activated, they start to spit out cytokines. So cytokines are small proteins, typically in the order of 15 to the atom. And that's relatively efficient. They spit out like 10 molecules per second. And very often, at the same time, they start making the receptor for the cytokine. Right? So this goes and starts to diffuse inside the extracellular medium. And if you have another cell which has been activated at the same time, it does the same. Hopefully it makes the same cytokine, it contributes to the pool of the cytokines, it makes the cytokine receptors. And now you see that you're going to start to self-organize the system in such a way that they're going to be able to communicate with each other. Right? The cytokine pool, which is being shared by all these T cells, you can use it as some kind of form sensing the way bacteria are working. Right? You are generating this kind of public good. I want to use the bacterial community. You are using this kind of diffusible element to be able to synchronize the way each individual T cell gets activated. And really what I wanted to point out, so again, this happens much slower, right? It takes you time to accumulate enough cytokine in such a way that you can start to bind it and to consume it and so on and so forth. So this is more on a time scale of maybe 3 hours to 3 days. But what you see is that if you start to ramp up and to tune the amount of this public, the rate at which you are making these cytokines start to be tunable, if it relates to the quality of activation that you had at early time points, you're going to be able to translate this minute time self-non-self estimation that you made into a much longer time scale decision. And not only that, you're going to be able to use some kind of averaging between different agents, between different T cells, to hopefully make a much better decision. So yes, we had something which was very sharp in terms of self-on-self on the short time scale. Very sharp, but potentially very noisy. So each T cell makes a very black and white decision on the short time scale. They are very sure they saw something, they are very sure they didn't see anything, whatever. But then you can go into longer, bigger scale in terms of space, because it's going to involve maybe a whole lymph node or a whole spleen. Bigger scale in terms of time scale, you can really integrate it over a very long time scale. And you're going to be able to make some dynamics to be able to read the initial quality of the activation into some kind of cell-cell communication. Right? So using this cell-cell communication, hopefully, potentially, you can make a better decision. You're going to be able to check whether cells, individual cells made a mistake. Maybe you're going to do some kind of form sensing of the way bacteria operate. So you're going to try to accumulate enough of this cytokine to be able to close this loop and to make them communicate with each other. And in a sense, you're going to set some threshold in the system, but on a longer time scale. Okay?
What's the lifetime of this sample?
Indeed. The lifetime of the protein itself, that's, you have it in your blood. Mm-hmm. If you don't do anything, it's going to stay there. Right? Month, no problem. But the lifetime of a particular cytokine, practically, because it can bind to the receptor, and as soon as you bind, you get endocytosis, maybe 1 minute. Right? So, it's not that the lifetime of a protein is really affecting the way it stays in the system, it's really the way it's going to be produced and consumed, which is going to generate very nice dynamics that I want to dissect.
But there's nothing in the medium which is degrading.
There are some cases of some T cell can express something which binds this thing and annihilate this signal for others. It can get more complicated. For the sake of discussion, let's make it in a generic manner. You generate this protein which is very stable, it can diffuse. If it binds to the receptors, it gets endocytosis. So to give you numbers, 10 molecules per second, that's the rate at which you can spill out the cytokines. The typical KD for these interactions is on the order of 10 picomolar. So that's very small, right? If this is something which binds extremely strongly, then the typical rate of endocytosis is on the order of 10 minutes. So what that means is that the way the system is going to work is the way we're going to build our model, is that in a sense, the cells get activated, they hear the start mark, they start to get activated. They start making accumulating some cytokines. In a sense, if they reach that concentration, and if they have been able to express the receptors, then you're going to be able to close these loops, or autocrine or paracrine. You're going to be able to consume this cytokine, and suddenly you're going to have a very narrow window of time where maybe you're producing enough cytokines and not enough receptors that the cytokine can stay on, and then it's going to get consumed, it's going to get switched off. So it's very rich in terms of dynamics, and we can use it to make a corrective decision.
So do all activated T cells release the same cytokines?
No. At time zero, right? Even if you take the pure population of cells, on a short time scale, yes.
Okay.
But then, based on these feedbacks, because of course, when you bind a cytokine, it's going to start signaling. It's going to start doing something inside the cell. Based on the feedback, they're going to start to diverge. Meaning that the cell which stays next to a source is going to get a particular signal very early on. And the cell which is much further away from the source, maybe it's going to take more time to accumulate the cytokines. They're going to be delayed. They're going to see the cytokine in different contexts. And that's the way you're going to be able to really split the population of cells. So in the context of this kind of tree of differentiation, that's one of the main mechanisms to explode the diversity of the cell. They are really going to be able to generate many different phenotypes. I'll discuss more about that in the next session.
Are there therapies now where we can directly deliver cytokines?
So, these cytokines were discovered in the mid-80s, and you doctors are very nice because they want to try, right? So they took this cytokine, so I'm going to tell you a lot about this IL-2 cytokine. Despite its name, it was the first one discovered. This stuff is magic. You give it to T cells, and your T cells explode by a factor of 10 to the 6, right? So, the time bomb, right? You inject, I mean, Thomas mentioned it in his lecture. You inject that inside a patient, it can have very different effects. If you inject too much of it, you just flood. It's really a good way to die because you just flood the patient, and it's very nasty. If you treat it in a nice way, you can really boost a certain population of cells, boost some regulatory elements. And if you, inject it at a different time in different dose, you're going to boost a different population of cells. So yes, a lot of what we do in terms of modeling is geared towards understanding this feedback because we want to be able to manipulate that in patients. And the first approach that doctors had, which is, we discovered cytokine, let's purify it, let's inject it. They killed a lot of people in a very nasty way because very, very subtle, right? And you see that these numbers, if you start to wire up a model, you can really do different things. I'm going to show you a bit about that.
They didn't try it in the mouse first?
Of course, they tried in the mouse. That's the beauty of the immune system. What works in the mouse is not correct in humans. I don't know if you remember this story in England 3 years ago. We had these very wonderful molecules to be able to block any of these others. And tried the mouse, trying in the rat, they try in monkeys, wonderful. And then they do this very small clinical trial in humans. Six individuals, you inject a tiny dose just to check whether it's toxic. You inject these people every 20 minutes and then you wait. 3 hours later, the first one goes into a coma. 20 minutes later, the second one goes into a coma. So we have these molecules which everybody believed that they understood what they did. And when they tested it in humans, surprise, it was very different. So we have to be very careful because we are living with a time bomb inside our body. Right? This stuff is extremely potent, and we have to be able to anticipate better how it works, and that's kind of what we do some of it. Right, so for the last 10 minutes of this lecture, I just want to give you a sense about something related to the problem of synthetic variability. So again, ultimately, we want to start to understand ourselves communicate with each other, because we want to understand how we go from this very short-term scale where cells are kind of discriminating different repertoire of ligands from the short-term scale, and maybe they start to speak to each other, they start to communicate based on cytokines to be able to make a better decision. What I'm going to focus on right now is something which is more related to biophysics, just going to be about the way the cells sense the cytokine. So, typically again, you look at the surface of the cells, a lot of cytokine receptors are made of the alpha chain, and maybe beta, gamma, details of the memory matter. Then you come with a cytokine, let's say IL-2, it binds, it forms the full complex, it deprimerizes, and as soon as it deprimerizes, you're going to use one of its stat proteins, which is going to get phosphorylated. And this goes into the nucleus, and start gene processes. So very simple radio, right? You just have a receptor, it binds to a cytokine, it phosphorylates the transcription factor. Transcription factor moves to the nucleus and starts repressing and activating something. Very simple cascade. We should be able to do the math for that. So it turns out that we like this system very much because everything is known. All the interactions, interactions between these receptors have been measured. So in a way, we should be able to build a model very efficiently. So again, you go back and you build some very simple biochemistry. IL-2 plus IL-2 alpha, so plus the alpha chain, is going to form a complex. And then this complex, let's say, plus the beta and gamma, forms the full complex. And this you're going to use to phosphorylate this alpha. So I'm showing you the original model that we had, which is a very simplified model. And we're going to go to something more complex after that. But the point is that this very simple model already has some very nice features. What we find out is that the level of this beta-gamma is fairly constant. You have 10 to the 3, 10 to the 4 copies of these receptors. So in a sense, I kind of lied to you when I said the cytokine receptor gets expressed upon activation. Some of them are always there, right? These chains are always there. But they are non-functional. They get functional only when the data chain gets expressed. And this guy goes from 0 to 10 to the 7. And not only that, is that when you look at the population of cells, you measure the level of alpha. So again, because we have this single cell resolution, you can take cells from a mouse which has been infected, we can take cells from a patient. What we see is that we see a distribution which is like that, very spread out. But here, I'm really telling you something which is not. Our limit of resolution is maybe 100. From 100 to 10 to the 7, with a CV which is maybe on the order of 6. Right? So huge diversity. And this is coming from a pure population of cells. Right? All these cells started at 0. When I started at 0, they were all here. You come back 24 hours later, and you get this complete spread of T cells. Right? So, again, the idea of robustness can is a bit funny here because if you want something non-robust, that's that, right? You get a completely flat distribution across practically 70 cases, and the cells are very viable in the way they express the receptors. Just to go back to your questions, this is going to generate a lot of diversity. Some cells, for some reason, are lucky. They may express a huge quantity of receptors. They're going to become kind of a sink, which steals the cytokines from everybody else. And the ones which are left behind, they have less receptors, maybe they are not good enough at binding the cytokine, And these are going to be the suckers who are producing, who keep producing the cytokines. I'll show you that a bit more later. But basically, inside this distribution, you're going to start to split into subbeams, right? You're going to start to get some variable response to a given IL-2. And that's going to generate very diverse T cells. And that's going to generate a lot of variability in the way these cells are wired. And that's going to generate a lot of richness in the dynamics of the system. So I showed you this model in a very simplified manner, because already with this model, again, we know the parameters, you know, the KD for these things have been measured. You can do, if you have some fun, you can do this math. It's very simple. What's very important is that you see that this alpha chain is kind of a gatekeeper. So to be able to bind a cytokine to the surface of the cells, first you're going to bind to this chain because it has a very weak affinity, but there are a lot of them, right? So you form these very weak bindings, and then you're going to lock it up. In fact, this rate is so large that it's practically infinite. You're going to lock it up into a full complex, which is going to start to slow. Because it's two-step binding, because this alpha chain is really limiting, you're going to expect a lot of variability in the wave system response. So if we take different population of cells, right, if we go back to an experiment and we analyze the response to the cytokine inside the system, we can measure the level of P-stat-5, we can measure the level of alpha, beta, gamma inside the individual cells. We can make this kind of four-dimensional map of the response of the system, and we put more parameters. And what we find is that as we titrate the cytokine in vitro, and as we look at the stat-5 response inside the system, what we get is that the cells which have a very high level of receptors respond at practically 0.1 picomolar, so 100 picomolar. In the same population, the cells which are less lucky and which have very low level of receptors, they respond maybe at more than 1 nanomolar. And again, it's really a very simple idea, right? Because you're using a two-step binding model, because you first pre-calibrate your cytokine on the surface of the cell, so whatever cloud of this cytokine you have inside the system, they are going to kind of pre-calibrate on the surface of the cells based on the level of this alpha chain, and then you're going to lock it up with beta-gamma and you're going to start signaling. Well, that means that inside this distribution of cells, you're going to get some cells which can respond to practically 100 femtomolar, which means practically a single molecule, and if you scale it back to the level of individual cells. And inside the same population, you have cells which can maybe 10 to 4 molecules or more to get going. So you hear a lot about the 1% and Occupy Wall Street and the distribution of wages in the US. Well, we're kind of dealing with that in the context of the lymphocytes. All these lymphocytes are not different. They might be born with the same receptors. They might be activated, all of them, in a similar manner on the short time scale. Within 24 hours, the rich are going to become very sensitive. They're going to have a lot of receptors. And they are really going to start to bind the cytokine in a very efficient manner. And the one left behind, well, they are not very lucky, their threshold of activation becomes so high that practically they are not going to be able to see the cytokine. And this kind of discrepancy, this kind of phenotypic variability, is really a critical component of this system. You cannot model one T cells and make some kind of average behavior and propagate these T cells and cross immune response. You want to deal with the ability to make distribution, because in a sense you're going to make many different types of sensors. Some cells are going to be extremely responsive. They might do something that proliferate and start to kill. Some cells might do something else. In that case, these guys are going to become memory cells, which are not going to proliferate, and it's going to stay behind. What I want to emphasize is that we cannot model a single T cell and assume that the average behavior dictates the behavior of the system. You have to deal with this distribution, understand where it comes from, and understand what it does to the system.
Do something like FACS or antibody conjugated sorting to pull out the most sensitive ones from a population?
Right. So what you can do is, and again, that's the beauty of the immune system, this is a fluid system. So I can go back, harvest the cells from the blood of the mouse, stain them for this alpha, sort them into different beams, right? You can pass them with the FACS and with an electric field, you're going to sort different subpopulations. And then I can put them back into different mouse. Or I can stain them and then track what they do. And that's the way we found out that these are the factors. These are the cells that are really going to proliferate and kill. And these are the kind of the dull, quiet cells which are going to stay memory cells. So that's exactly the experiment we do, is that we can sort the cells, we can cut this distribution, put it back into different mouse, put it back in the same mouse, and start to see how these populations interact with each other, and start to understand how the cell-cell communication really matters to make a decision. So I wanted to do something a bit more sophisticated of modeling, but I guess I stop now. Questions? I'm next anyway, so.
Just a raised question. If you put the memory cells into different maps, is it now immune to the disease?
Yeah. So this population, these guys, they are the happy go-go, right? They start to proliferate, they start to spill out some cytokines, and then they crash. And they've been partying so much, they exhausted their proliferation capacities, and they just die. These cells, they kept it to themselves. They didn't start to proliferate at all. They didn't contribute any cytokines. So in a way, they're in a very quiescent state. They're going to have a very long lifetime. In the case of our experiment, we can stick around for like 2 months, 3 months, most likely the whole age of the mouse. And when you reactivate them, you see that they are very sensitive. So they are the cell that you use for this memory state for the vaccine.
Okay, so we're running late. I think we should wrap it up now. Get a coffee and we'll